maybe I hold the original one near and dear to my heart because that was the first real success that I ever had in the music business, and it was a fun time, it was an exciting time. It changed my life.
We basically made the record, I guess it was 3 or 4 months after becoming a band, so I think it's a very raw and very young sounding record.
The song part was easy, it was like putting all these together, one after another.
Since we made our second record, we've been thinking about remixing the 10 record. This reissue was kind of an opportunity to go back and kind of finish what we started.
I'd like to welcome Eddie and Mike from the band Pearl Jam. Two of your members that aren't here right now, Stone and Jeff, were in Mother Love Bone together. And how did the rest of you guys all kind of hook up?
I was surfing in San Diego and I heard from my friend Jack, who used to be in Chili Peppers. So I sent up a tape, and all of a sudden I was living in Seattle.
Stone and Jeff were rock stars around Seattle. So, to me, and I had to ask Stone after we started jamming after about a week, I said, are we going to start a band? What do you want to do? He said yes, and I just kind of went, okay.
It didn't sound like Mother Love Bone to me, so it seemed like Stone was going for something different at that point.
And then we got Matt to do the demos.
It was just a fun thing to do.
Not only is he like an incredible drummer, but you could actually ask him to come and say, you know, we're going to cut these demos. It's going to take you like 30 seconds to learn these songs. Can you just please come in and play on them?
It was really fun. We didn't
work at it at all. I think we practiced once or twice, maybe. Did we practice more than that?
A couple times, yeah.
When Stone and I were in L.A. promoting the Mother Love Bone record,
we were like, okay, well, maybe we should just be bold enough to call up Jack Irons and see what he's doing, because we heard he wasn't, you know, at that time he wasn't playing with the Chili Peppers anymore, so.
We gave him a demo tape, and we desperately asked him if he wanted to play with us.
And literally just asked him on the way out the door, you know, if you know of any singers, let us know. So he said, yeah, I do. I know a guy. Crazy Eddie.
We got this tape in the mail from Ed, and I threw it in the tape machine, and I was pretty blown away by it the first time that I heard it, and I played it again, and I thought, wow, this is great. Like, and it was really, really a departure from really anything that Stone and I had done before. And I called Stone up and said, you got to come over right now. You got to listen to this thing. But I think it's pretty good.
And Eddie sent 3 songs back, and one of them was Footsteps, one of them was Once, one of them I think was Alive.
I knew that that original Mama Son cassette was somewhere, but I hadn't listened to it in 17 years or whatever, 18 years, 19. It was cool to sit down and play it, you know, for the first time with Ed and see his reaction. To find that 90% of it stayed exactly the same as what ended up on the record. And I think he said he spent 5 or 6 hours on those 3 songs, so.
I knew this was one of the moments that only comes once in a band's career.
I think that that first week that we played with Ed, we knew that there was something happening at that point.
And a lot of influences that, when they messed with the influences that I had, really kind of created this, you know, with the whole band, but just how everybody was kind of meshing to kind of create this thing.
I remember being very kind of stoic and staid and would sing with this incredible voice, but just kind of would stand there.
I felt probably more connected to what he was saying and how he was singing, and the voice that he brought to the band, I felt more connected to that than any other band I'd ever been in.
He was the missing piece to our band.
At that point, it was just, okay, now can we put a record out? And we had friends that said, yeah, you can put a record out.
We were up in Lenbridge Studios in North Seattle when we recorded 10. We brought in those ideas of Jeff and Stone and I who had been working on, and Ed had sung on over a period of a week.
When we made it in about, you know, probably a total of about 2.5 weeks. So I think in that sense, I think we're more proud of it than anything, because it was like no pressure, and we just went in and we just did it.
We just dove right into it and wrote a bunch of songs. So then we knew it was on, at least in that sense.
I felt that we were all playing really great and fantastic, and I felt this is the first time that there was 5 guys that I was in a situation with and a band that everybody was firing on all cylinders.
You write your songs and then you got them and then you go out and play them and try to put yourself into them and hope for the best.
Ed and I have always been super hands-on with all the art, and the 10 version we had pretty severe restrictions in terms of what we could do. Like, they didn't let us put it out in vinyl.
See, I hate holding up a CD. I want to hold up an album.
And, that was a rough blow to us at the time, because I don't even know if I had a CD player.
That's why we fought to get a fold-out that was big as an album. That's true. Now it's bigger than an album, but it's kind of flimsy.
If we're selling enough records to keep making more records, I think that was the goal at that point, was to be in a situation where we could get out and play and reach some sort of potential that we thought we might have.
Videos first kind of came out, it was this interesting thing. If you go before that, you'd listen to songs with the headphones on, sitting in a beanbag chair with your eyes closed, and you'd come up with your own visions and see these things for the song that came from within. And then all of a sudden, sometimes even the very first time you heard a song, it was with these visual images attached. And it robbed you of, again, this kind of any form of self-expression. And so it seemed like doing things live, it was just kind of a better way to keep that stuff sacred. And if they wanted to attach a live image or, you know, picture Stone playing the guitar or something on their head, then that would be fine.
It's a live, and it's actually not even that version. It's a live version that we recorded in Seattle, just for the video.
There's no way with a song like that, which talks about living for the moment, that we're going to like lip sync something that we had recorded a few months ago. So what you see and hear is just all live one night in Seattle.
I get the energy from the music that we're playing, and I feed off of the other guys in the band, and if everybody else in the band is having a great show, I automatically am having a great show.
It was fun like it was fun in the clubs, you know, in Seattle, where, you know, you're just playing a show, and then all of a sudden it just erupted into some kind of craziness.
Alive is something that would encapsulate the lyricism, the musicianship, and the feeling of this band.
Just played it once, and then I think we played it once for encore too, and told the crowd, play it again. And
right. That was for Alive, and for Even Flow, we played
Alive
once.
Was just one, yeah.
Eddie brought up the mixes to 10. And I distinctly remember hearing the chorus for Even Flow. I'm just thinking, like, that's huge.
Videos have basically been just like documenting our live performance, so, and we really haven't, I don't think we're at the point yet where we want to start taking on making, like, you know, mini movies or whatever. So
forget videos, come see us live.
Definitely. Us knew how to harness the energy that was flying around when we played those shows. Even when we weren't playing a show, there was energy flying around.
things had blown up, and we were planning on putting a free show on for Seattle because it was our home, and it turned out that, you know, 50,000 people responded to it.
Okay, we're here in Seattle. This is Drop in the Park, and if you drop in the park, you can drop in the grass, you can drop in here.
Wow, look at that.
It's a free show, it's a free atmosphere.
This giant field of, I don't know how many thousands, 30,000 people or something, and just mud and arms and people just being excited.
Listening to the tracks, it's pretty cool. I mean, I think it's pretty representative of what a visceral band we were at that point. Like, it was less about our abilities as musicians and more about our abilities to kind of bring out some emotion out of this thing that made a lot of noise and having a lot of volume behind it. It just felt like that was the right way for us to kind of finish up that year and a half. Kind of made sense for us to come back home and just to give something back to the city.
The news media was a lot more. It is very relevant to in America today.
If you want me to tell you what the song is about, I don't want to tell what the song is about, because a lot of these lyrics have been open to interpretation, and people who have taken them, they've become part owners. And if I were to just explain literally what the song is about, then that excludes that.
We just saw some work by this guy named Mark Pellington.
I felt honored to be interpreting his song.
He's gonna be doing some layering stuff and some double exposures, and it's got editing. He's drawing a piece of glass and surreal shots of members of the band standing or just looking or walking.
I remember the casting board, looking at these tapes, and all these kids are just being all angst-ridden, and like, ooh, I'm so angst-ridden, and this kid just did nothing, which now, 8 years later, trying to make movies, I realize that the theater actors do nothing, and so much comes across. Oh,